In September 2018, the British synth duo Soft Cell reunited for a one-off concert, the biggest of their career.
I just thought, well, let's do these things that Soft Cell have always done and go out on the limb and take a risk. And I just said, let's do the O2.
And then suddenly it's like sold out, so it's kind of unbelievable, really.
Mark Almond and Dave Ball shot to sudden success in the early 80s.
Sometimes I feel I've got to run away.
Soft Cell are the great electro pop heroes of the 80s.
Say hello, wave goodbye.
Mark's voice, it's like this strange mix between power and strength and vulnerability.
No one knows I'm here for sure.
The synths just went straight in. That's what I love.
Dancing, laughing.
Soft Cell set out to subvert the mainstream, not to become conventional pop stars.
It's looking into the heart of urban darkness and finding the romance of it and loving it.
Their story is one of creative and personal extremes.
In a band, there's going to be all that sex and drugs and rock and roll, and it's a cliche, but it's a fact.
And a devastating split in 1984.
It was so dramatic, it was so emotional. I think we were both very, very tired, quite depressed.
We both agreed if we don't stop, we're probably one of us is going to die.
We can now come together and celebrate the music that we made over that time and the fact that it's lasted a legacy of 40 years.
Nowhere so tragic as a resort out of favor. I am lonely and my heart is like the old arcade. Somewhere down the promenade, choked with sand.
I always felt an outsider because I just couldn't communicate with people very well. I still socially can't communicate with people all that well in social situations. In Southport, I did have some really good friends there. We kind of gravitated towards each other. We were all kind of strange, lonely people. I was quite sick as a child and had bronchitis and asthma, and my grandfather used to take me down on the beach. I mean, he just used to ride me on his shoulders going down the tide line and the beach and sing Strangers in Paradise. So I always had this song, Strangers in Paradise, from Kismet in my ear. And it was a wonderful place, because Southport has this kind of melancholy romanticism to it. As long as my father wasn't around, I was really happy, you know. So with my grandparents and my mum, I was really happy. I think there's enough to just say that I was happy when my father wasn't around.
Youth has gone, though we're still young. It's hard, I know, to believe that I was somebody's son.
I just yearned for other things. I'd listened to David Bowie and read Our Lady of the Flowers by Jean Genet, and realised there was something else going on out in the world. This respectability of Victorian middle-classness that I always felt was about Southport. There was this other world going on. And I've always loved that. I've always found that this other world that go on behind the doors of respectability. I kind of worked at the Southport Theatre as a stagehand for a while. And so I met lots of people travelling from theatre to theatre, variety acts and female impersonators who'd come to, and pantomime figures. I had a very strong friendship, shall we say, with a much older person than me. I got into art college in Southport. I was a terrible painter and a terrible sort of sculptor. I couldn't do any of that, really. My heart was always in kind of doing more performance-based things where I could use myself in that. I become this person that I can go out on stage and be this other Mark Almond.
I loved all the neon light. You go to the seafront, there were loads of people around it, and it was quite exciting. But no, I always felt like an outsider when I was at school, because I think I was probably the only adopted child in my school. But it was also, I was quite a lonesome sort of person when I was a kid. I mean, I tend to just lock myself in my room. I started kind of collecting records, and I was into music. And everywhere in Blackpool they were playing, all the clubs were playing Northern Soul. Sometimes I feel I've got to run away. I first heard Tainted Love when I was 16. Don't touch me,
please, I cannot stand the way you... I never liked that song. I never liked the word tainted. That was my problem. I just didn't understand the word. Because I was a virgin. So I was clean. So this was like, oh, I'm saying something nasty.
It's got this sort of passion, beautiful melodies, but sort of heartbreaking at the same time. That kind of duality that always appealed to me and Mark. I had a job working for this Italian ice cream firm, and there was this young guy, and he pulled out this little cassette, which was like, ding, 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 ding. I said, what is this? It's fantastic. It's like sine waves and square waves and stuff, and I was hooked. One ear was going Northern Soul, and in the other ear was going Kraftwerk, and somewhere in between it was like, became Soft Cell, really, eventually.
I think the first early Soft Cell was something that kind of just grew out of work we were doing at art college. It was almost like an art college project.
This was one of our haunts when we were at the Leeds Poly, which is just a few yards behind us. Mark used to come past there was a little studio in this college, and they'd hear these sort of bleeps and weird sounds coming out of this room, and I'd be in there with all these reel-to-reel tape recorders and
tape loops,
making
as well.
tape loops and messing about with delays and stuff. And Mark said, would you be interested in doing some sort of music, I use the word broadly, for my performances?
And I did the experimental theatre art performances. Well, the review said I've never seen anything so that was the most nihilistic, depressing piece I've ever had to misfortune to see, which I love that. I had no qualms about taking my clothes off, about being very kind of naked and very raw. So I've always been very out there with kind of emotions.
So that's how it started.
This slightly eccentric couple, you know, Dave, very tall, very taciturn, but sort of quietly funny, and then Mark, this sort of jangle of nervous energy and laughter, but the charisma as well. And for me, Dave just provided this kind of grounding for Mark.
But I also think that Mark brought him out a bit more, because he was quiet and shy, so he helped to bring him out. Boom. You know, they both had their own thing, and the magic just got stronger when they came together.
It was a great time to be at the college, because for musically, even through all those years, you see so many different
there
bands.
There was so much going on. It was just like, you know, this mad kind of melting pot of different ideologies, like the sort of wealth of the sort of disco.
I For Love was a really game-changing record, really.
Absolutely. And the streetness of the sort of punk.
The Anarchy Tour came to the Polytechnic,
And it was just a sort of smashing together and making this new kind of thing, you know, which very much influenced us, because we were, I would say, what we were really kind of electronic punk. Misery complains out, pity injustice.
Misery complains out, pity injustice. Even when we were successful, we always still stuck to small, intimate venues, because that's where we felt it was kind of confrontational.
By the end of the show, everyone in the room was up on the stage with us. And in fact, you couldn't see where Mark was by the end of the gig. It was fabulous, absolutely fabulous.
I think we played one of our first real gigs, wasn't it? What we considered,
yeah. It was the first time we got paid.
That was amazing.
And we got 20 quid each. I mean, don't spend it all at once.
Had riots, huge unemployment, massive unemployment. When Mark came along, he wasn't afraid to talk about the reality of his life, and which was reflecting other people's lives at that time, you know, this sense of quiet despair.
Steve-O did just seem like this brilliant chancer with really good instincts and really genuinely sort of subversive instincts.
Awareness of knowing what cannot be seen cannot be known. Nonconformity widens variety. Make new, original, nonconformist music.
I did like that about him. I liked the fact that Soft Cell had kind of just said, yeah, OK, you can manage us. You know, I really liked the spirit, you know, the DIY indie spirit of those times.
I've listened to this for about 40 years. One, two, three. Recognise that?
Sometimes I feel I've got to run away, I've got to get away from the pain you drive into the heart of me.
Once we always had great fun doing this, and you're going to hear in a moment where we occasionally burst into bits of laughter. Love you given, I give you all the So, yes, we always had a bit of fun in the studio.
Many groups come and make it quickly and then disappear. What about you?
Well, we're not going to disappear. That's far as I'm concerned, anyway.
Well, you sort of never really sort of think that you are going to get that far. Like, one week you're watching Top of the Pops and next week you're on it.
Sometimes I feel I've got to run away.
I thought it was great having a platform on Top of the Pops where you could be subversive. Because there's no point in being subversive if you can't have a platform.
We didn't really want to be a pop group. We wanted to be arty. Phonogram told Mark that he's got to wear no eyeliner and take off his bangles. And so he said, we can F off for that as well. So we just did exactly what we wanted. Take my tears and that's not nearly all tainted love. And the switch was for jammed, weren't they? That was such a good sign.
People like the words are like, you know.
Maybe about everything.
Mother you, murder you, or fuck you, one of the. Of both sexes.
Sales of bangles and mascara went through the roof the next day, so, and black t-shirt with cap sleeves, you know. Now I'm gonna pack my
things and go. It was transgressive, I think. It was very transgressive at the time, and I saw the reactions that it could get.
That's more reality to me, it's Tainted Love, than another kind of love song. We all know, we've all had a bit of tainted love.
It could still destroy your career to admit that you were gay. It's almost impossible to think of that now. But, you know, it was obvious to me that Mark was gay, but he never talked about it because you just didn't. It just wasn't something that was discussed.
I am guilty in one respect of placing Mark in a group of waypavers, all these sexually ambiguous, at least, men often at number one in the charts. And so I was really fearless, you know, when it came to being out.
Mark liked sending postcards. And this is the first postcard that he sent me 37 years ago. And it was to celebrate the fact that Tainted Love had got to number one. He says, "Dear Auntie B, well, number one. Who'd have thought it? And what can you say, etc., etc. Love, Mark, bracket soft sell."
A better manager, a more sussed manager, certainly would not have allowed them to put another cover version on the other side of Tainted Love. You know, and Mark might have a country mansion now in Buckinghamshire. The strings
right up. We had no idea how huge Tainted Love was going to be. I think it's like the pressure to, you know, we were two kids, really. We didn't know what we were doing in the music business. We suddenly had the biggest selling record of the year in the UK and at number one in 17 countries.
We were finding ourselves getting into a kind of a smash hits flexi-pop world and we were kind of dismissed.
Yes. Even some of those teeny mugs, they used to go, which one do you fancy more, Mark or Dave? And like, say, what's your favourite colour? I remember someone did one of those questions for a pop mag once and they said, what's your favourite colour? He said, helmet purple.
I didn't say that, did I?
Not you.
The pressure, particularly on Mark, to be who the media wanted them to be, that they just didn't feel that they could be these, what Mark would say, tinselly little pop things.
We had this success that was sort of unstoppable at the time, and it was kind of, I don't know, we didn't really want that.
We weren't our college band, really.
Yeah, getting into the indie charts. We would have been happy to be in the indie charts.
So there was tremendous pressure on them to then come out with lots more pop hits.
I had this strong memory of meeting them and being very struck by just how resistant they were to becoming just another kind of Top of the Pops fixture. Right from the bat, Soft Cell was saying, you know, we're going into much darker areas.
We said, well, Bedsitter was always a favourite with the fans, and the record companies said, didn't like it. And we were like in total despair. We thought our career was over, we're going to be one hit wonders. Eventually, it came out.
Very Jean Genet in a way. It's looking into the heart of urban darkness and finding the romance of it and loving it. Mark brings his better and his worst angels to the material.
Sunday morning, going slow, I'm talking to the radio.
Bedsitter does remind me of living in just a one room with a bed and the cooker.
Out in clubland having fun, and now I'm hiding from the sun.
Just hoping you had enough money by the weekend to be able to go out and get dressed up and go and hopefully meet someone.
Dancing, laughing, drinking, loving. And now I'm all alone in Bedsit Land, my only home.
The song Bedsitter was very much based on our time in Leeds. And we did actually write it in our bedsit.
I was introduced to the songs of Jacques Brel as well, which again led me to the style, which is like a chanson, French style, songs of life and love and the street, and but also with a thread of romanticism.
Brel sings about the old subjects, love and love gone wrong. But he sings too about the ugly, the sick and the dying, tramps and tarts, the flotsam and jetsam of society. He is on their side.
And listening to Jacques Brel and watching Jacques Brel, he was also very kind of confrontational.
Adieu les mille, je t'aimais bien. Adieu les mille, je t'aimais bien, tu sais.
I always felt that that influence came into Soft Cell as well.
I think it's time to cook a meal to fill the emptiness I feel. Spend my money going outside, nothing in, I'm left without.
I think there's a lot about Dave's songs arrangements. There's so many songs that make me feel so uneasy and edgy, thinking, well, I should be kind of, I should be really, you know, having a dance to it, but it's something that makes me feel really uncomfortable,
yeah,
and chilling.
Right.
Slightly chilling, I
What's
think.
What's wrong with this picture?
Like those, like the violin notes in Psycho.
Yeah. It wasn't going to be a Tainted Love. We couldn't just keep doing Tainted Loves. But it still did very well. It still got to number four in the UK charts, which I think is very respectable, you know. The reason it wasn't a hit in America, because obviously Tainted Love had been massive.
They don't know what bedsitter is.
They don't know what a bedsitter is.
They've got a condo.
What's a bedsitter, man? They just didn't relate to the lyrics. There was just no...
Microloft.
Yeah. A condo. Yeah. Now we're alone in condo.
Loveland.
We should
record it and put it Microloft.
Yeah.
The dust cart is rattling down the street, picking up bin bags on the way. Heard a prostitute wailing that every guy she meets must be gay, because she hasn't made a penny and there's a month of bills to pay.
Mark always used to use the term glamour and squalor. He was always into that sort of, that kind of underworld sort of prostitutes and the pimps and the drug dealers. But there was a sort of glamour about it, which is what attracted us eventually to Soho.
Become a gaudy jungle of sex emporiums and cinemas. Almost every second shop you see has sex for sale in some shape or form.
I mean, some of the magazines along here, for example, I think are calculated to cause shock.
I thought Soho was London, and I thought Soho, if you came down to Soho, you were in London. I actually got a job in a clip joint in Green Court in Soho, which was kind of a criminal activity, really. And I write about these stories and people that I'd met and things that I, adventures that I had. So it was a perfect little place for us to set an album like Nonstop Erotic Cabaret. We thought we were being kind of like, there's a lot of sense of humour about it. But on reflection, it's probably, you just think, it really all fed into this whole thing that we're just this kind of shallow group about sleaze.
Hey, that's fine. Got no time. Meet me on Friday down in Blue City. Got no address, just a telephone number.
I mean, Mark had to go through a lot of criticism for that and the way that he was exploring it. In fact, you know, Mark would often say, you know, I was always more of a voyeur than anything else. And there was a sort of obsession about the fact that he was this sort of grubby little pervert, when really it was, I think it was speaking to a lot of what was going on under the surface in the culture at the time.
Well, we felt that Soho was this little microcosm of a city,
yeah.
That what life was really, this other world that was going on behind doors, what was really kind of going on behind doors in politics as well, what real life was about. So the secrets and the scandals.
Standing in the door of the Pink Flamingo, crying in the rain.
Say hello, wave goodbye. It's glamorous, but absolutely shot through that, you know, prism of glitter and grime and sensuality and sleaze.
I tried to make it work. You in a cocktail skirt and me in a suit. Well, it just wasn't me.
The lyrics were about maybe somebody important, someone like a politician or a lord or somebody who has an affair with a street girl.
a stripper or a prostitute.
Trying to hush things up and put, you know, push things under the carpet. So yeah, he's poking a bit of fun at the British establishment and on the British conventions and double standardness. So that was a bit of a comment on that. Sex Dwarf, which is probably the most outrageous track, you know, on that album, was to show the hypocrisy of the British media, because Mark had spotted that, the headline in what was then the news.
Sex Dwarf lures disco dollies
and
to
said,
a life
Dave,
of vice.
Dave, yeah. He said, going, look at this headline, we've got to do a song about this. And so we just lifted it verbatim, really, I mean, and turned it into a song.
Isn't it nice? Sugar and spice, luring disco dollies to a life of vice. I could make a film and make you my star. You'd be a natural the way you are.
We went a bit too far when we did Sex Dwarf. I mean, we've got Duran Duran doing videos on yachts with lots of beautiful girls around.
It was a reaction against that.
And we're doing videos with dwarves with chainsaws and bondage masks. And it was a bit of a sort of like that.
I think that video ended up causing quite a bit of trouble for us.
I think it's great, though. I think it has a legend. And then the next thing, we're back in the news of the world.
So it was live imitating art.
You know, yeah, it was like, really, it was, we took the headline to them. Then we're top pop group, Soft Cell, you know, get raided by Vice Squad in Soho offices. And it was like, well, it's gone like, you know, it shows the hypocrisy of the media.
I think at that time, we were lucky to be in New York at that time, at the beginning of the 80s, because it really was a different place than it is now. There was a fantastic whole downtown scene of art people and creative people doing amazing things. I mean, we were taken to meet Andy Warhol at the factory. We were like a new band in town. And everyone wanted to know us.
Mark once said, you know, in New York, people knew who they were, but they could still be anonymous. They could just go about what they wanted to do. A lot of that is what fed into the creative leaps that they made.
Well, Torch actually is one of my very favourite Soft Cell singles. Like someone just listening to, we're still those belligerent art students wanting to kind of like sabotage things for ourselves more than anything else. I always felt, looking back, we probably undersold ourselves a lot, I think. And in a way, going for something extreme like the O2 is the completely opposite.
Soft Cell never toured enough. When we did go to America, refused to play Tainted Love, which in retrospect was such a stupid move. Because, I mean, that was the only track that people knew us for. And even Michael Jackson came to see us in Los Angeles, and we didn't. I think he probably just came to see us play that number, and we didn't.
The Art of Falling Apart, you know, it's not exactly cozying up to the teenage demographic, and the cover was so unapologetically sort of sinister and disturbing, really. Let's write songs about the dark side and about promiscuity and about drugs and about the sort of spiritual decay at the heart of that.
We worked very hard and we were partied very hard.
All the experiences we were given, we kind of ate them all up, really, didn't we?
Well, yeah,
we had absorbed them all, whether it was meeting Andy Warhol or going to clubs
or
seeing all these very dodgy clubs.
Like the Hellfire Club.
Yeah, very hardcore clubs. There is quite a lot of kind of nihilism, I think, in Art of Falling Apart. I think Dave's arrangements were fantastic. There's all the filmic darks, sort of film noir, and it's full of this kind of, it's really this kind of weighty darkness.
There's a lot of romanticism as well, I think.
Yeah.
It's the sort of tragedy of, you know, that romantic sort of thing that I think Mark I think gets the lyrics, you know. In the heat of the night and the glow of the light, it's the fight and the night, this feeling alright. Do you use up bodies like cigarettes? Do you need them to be go? Do you need them for sex?
When I look at the album now, I look at it lyrically now, what it really seems to me is an album about just deterioration and decay. Do you use up bodies like cigarettes? Heat, which was kind of very kind of Tennessee Williams influenced, really, like Tennessee Williams, of repressed sexuality, of murder. Personally, with us as well, we'd really been through an intense time in the first two or three years, and it really was kind of taking its toll.
Both Mark and I are very impulsive people and very kind of addictive, you know, it goes with the lifestyle. And if you're out clubbing every night and you're in a band, there's going to be all that sex and drugs and rock and roll, and it's a cliche, but it's a fact, you know. And we fell into that trap.
I think it's probably quite clear that there's a direct correlation between the pressure that they felt to be a pop band and to keep churning out hits and their immersion, shall we say, into the drug scene, especially when they went to New York.
You start getting into harder drugs and then experimenting a bit with heroin, which is never a good idea, and even crystal meth.
We were very volatile and controllable. So the singles on Art of Falling Apart were Numbers and Where the Heart Is. I mean, Numbers was completely, like, off the scale for a single.
Numbers. Who's the person that you woke up next to today? If you were any older, then I know you'd have to pay your way.
A lot of quite sort of dissonant, disturbing minor chord stuff going on there. It's a sort of depiction of New York, not simply as a sort of hedonistic playground, but as quite a sort of disturbing nocturnal world.
Numbers. You're looking so thin these days, are you doing speed?
And the prefiguring of AIDS is extraordinary.
I heard on the radio about the first ever mention of what was to become known as AIDS at the time. And you kind of dismiss it at the time, you think it's just one of those things you hear about. But over the years of going there, you saw how it devastated the city. And it was generally a time of fear. I think most people I knew from that time are now dead.
Body one, body two, body three, body four.
And he was writing about something that was, again, was very provocative and divisive. And so that was a really quite dark and brave thing to do, and it's kind of astonishing. Intro into the first
couple of minutes of memorabilia, and really, when I look back, record company were just being a record company. They were just trying to do what record companies do. They wanted you to sell lots of records. It wasn't a commercial success they wanted us to be. So that kind of, we felt that feeling of kind of sourness between them, which kind of infected us, which kind of put a wedge between us as well, going in different directions. We lost track of each other. We felt that we lost that kind of chemistry, that initial great chemistry that we had together. And that's one of the reasons why we split up, really.
It was a kind of an arc, really, that you had this, you know, amazing ascent with Non-Stop Erotic Cabaret, which is our pop album. Then we had this sort of grown-up album, which was The Art of Falling Apart, which we started doing very, very early in our career. And then we sort of imploded by the third album, so it's like kind of bang, bang, bang. It was a new kind of energy. It was totally kind of from the heart. There was nothing contrived about it. It's called Surrender to a Stranger. A harder, sort of more industrial sound.
Lonely. I sit here acting like I'm reading. I'm reading minds and sadly dreaming. There's some of me left to believe in. Surrender. Surrender.
Sodom and Gomorrah, come tomorrow. I won't know you from Adam or Eve. Look me in the eyes and tell me you love me. What's before you leave?
People cite that as a really influential album.
It's so visceral, and also it really influenced people like Marilyn Manson. Yeah. A very influential record to a lot of musicians that came later. Personally, I really love it.
I have to admit, I found it really hard to listen to The Last Night in Sodom. I think because I knew some of the story of what was really going on, and because it was so dark, I just found it really hard to listen to.
I think after a while, you just have to look for another path for your music. And I think going down is quite a good idea.
It is quite tricky to end up coming out the other side unscathed.
We'd actually made a conscious decision to sort of disband for a while, but we still wanted to say something, and we almost wanted to do it in public. It's almost like a public execution, but self-execution, you know.
Really, it was very much the self-destructive, self-sabotage thing that addicts often have.
The wind in my hair and the black in my eyes. I was holding back tears as I reeled with surprise.
It's like I've always had this devil on my shoulder who's just saying, do this and see what happens. See what happens. It could be really interesting.
It's talking about freedom, really. Because he's bringing the wind in my hair. But as in the video, we're smashing up gold discs. I think some of them actually belong to Status Quo, which they weren't very pleased about. We just picked up an armful that we thought were ours and Phonogram Records. It sort of felt like a release record for us, that. To me, that's what it symbolises. It was an imminent freedom from this business.
I wish that we'd... Everything was so dramatic at that time. It was so intense, it was so dramatic, it was so emotional. I think we were both very, very tired, quite depressed.
And we didn't really have a manager to be, you know. Not, we needed someone who was in charge, who was in control, and we didn't have that.
I'm trying to hold on to the soul inside.
We both agreed that this is like, if we don't stop, we're probably one of us is going to die, you know. It's like, we're going to have to stop.
Was this mixture of kind of freedom and then fear, regret, thinking, well, what have I done? And then freedom, thinking, oh, now I can do whatever I like. And then this fear of, like, well, what am I going to do? I've always gone through my career just by accident, more than design. I don't really design things. I don't really say, this is my plan. But I think you go on this roller coaster ride. And it's, you have to see it's go ups and downs, it goes round and round. It takes you through these interesting landscapes, interesting cities, places, adventures.
cities have always been very influential to me. Cities are like love affairs. I love Paris because I love chanson, and Jacques Brel, and I recorded an album of Brel songs. And I love going to Paris on my own and just wandering about and taking in this kind of beauty and street life and sitting in a cafe and just being a chanson singer. So it's a great honour and a great thrill to be able to be here. Wow. It feels amazing to be here, actually, because you're actually in a piece of history, and it's got this amazing, spiritual, magical feel about you. You're in the Moulin Rouge. It's incredible. They hold each other's hand. They walk without a sound. Down forgotten streets, their shadows kiss the ground. Their footsteps sing a song that's ended before it's begun. They walk without a sound, the desperate ones. The perfect setting to sing some of those sort of romantically emotional ballads that also tell the story of the street.
Twilight of your career, do you want to look back and say, you know, I did a lot of music that I didn't really care about, but boy, did I make a lot of money? Or do you want to say, well, I actually made the music that I wanted to make?
Round like a circle in a spiral, like a wheel within a wheel, never ending or beginning on an ever-spinning reel, like a snowball down a mountain or a carnival balloon. Like a carousel that's turning, running rings around the moon. It's never really been about the success to me. It's always been about the adventure and the fairground ride. Like a clock whose hands are sweeping past the minutes of his face, and the world is like an apple whirling silently in space. Like the circles that you find in the windmills of your mind. I think Russia really, really it rejuvenated my creativity. I wanted something that was really going to excite me and to make me kind of give me a whole new adventure in life that I hadn't had before. And Russia did that. The British Council decided to take us over to give some British culture. And we were taken as a cheap date, really, yes. Because we'd done some acoustic shows in London,
yeah,
with the piano and vocal shows. Yeah. We arrived there, and I think it was a weird thing because when we kind of did these shows, and there wasn't even proper amplification or something, or no lighting.
It was
literally sort of on an orange box.
Bassadol pianos.
Really?
Yeah.
But I think the audience were fantastic, weren't they?
They were, yeah. They were just mad for it. Weren't they, really? It was
amazing that audiences came and they bought jars of jam, didn't they, and things, and tapes. And tapes, cassette tapes of Russian songs, yeah, and Russian, yeah, yeah, music, and said, you must listen to this, you must listen to it. And so that's how I first kind of collected sort of songs, yeah, and Russian songs. Yeah. Вона край зорвана платка. Finding this genre of songs, it was something that I could take and make my own because I had an understanding and a feeling of them. Some of them are quite cruel romances. I've done in this very Russian way, and they're often mixed with imagery of nature, like beautiful white flowers. There's always this feeling of darkness and war and lost soldiers and lost love, and it's very what they call the Russian soul.
Yeah,
I got to perform on stage with in front of generals and the Russian public who really embraced me and said, you are a son of Russia. You are adopted son of Russia because you have the Russian soul.
I don't really know where to go after Soft Cell. It's like I've gone through some sort of portal, which kind of was nice because it kind of calmed me down for quite a while. I started getting itchy feet and wanted to do stuff, not to get back into the music, because that's what I loved doing, that's what I did.
That's the weird thing. But when as soon as Roger, the banjo player, came on, it's like a banjo in the Ministry of Sound. And there were kids like standing at the front, like looking at you and wondering what it was.
There was these kind of techno purists in various magazines saying, I thought it was like, you know, well, I've got this one record and only four people have it in the world. And, you know, well, what can we do to, you know, we don't want these people to be like these ridiculous train spotters. You know, we want it to be, you know, it's a worldwide movement for people getting together.
But it was our biggest hit. I mean, it sold a million records, so.
People think, oh, the pop end's quite throwaway, but I think it's actually harder to make good pop records. Yeah, we can make experimental records till the cows come home.
It's a lot easier. Yeah. I mean, although having said that, we did a record for Moog Records using the System 55. I mean, that's more serious, isn't it? It's a bit more sort of beard stroke. We like to move around. There's lots of different areas to play with, and it's, you know, that's what you have to do, isn't it?
I mean, the good thing is, you know, we can not see each other for like 6 years, and then within 5 minutes, we're back on.
We're doing an album.
For me, it always has to come back to pop, because there's a quote, I think from Private Lives by Noel Coward, and it says, strange the potency of a cheap song. And it is, it's that a cheap pop song is so potent.
Try hard to make my money last the day. No way. Try
the kind of lovelorn sort of ballads, and I love those the most.
Stop the rain, try.
Something that kind of sticks in your head. With a catchy chorus and a click fingers. I always come back to that, and I always think I like to work with people that bring me back to that out of the complete artiness. We do love London, but we just fell a little bit out of love with it, of the passion in a way, because the way it's sort of changing away from the London that we love.
There was this sense that the last scruffy corners in London have gone. The buildings they put up now, everything looks the same.
Just an echo of a nightbird song.
Just a bit more piano. Just a bit more piano.
I've known Mark for a long time, and he's always finding new things and different areas that he's enjoying. And that comes out in his music and the way he's writing and the way he writes with me.
London, you are my lover, but I don't love you anymore. Though I'm willing to give you another chance if you dress just like I did before.
It's a luxury for me because I get to sing a type of song that I don't always get the chance to sing.
You were once a fair lady and you kept the competition away.
I consider myself quite an old-fashioned, old-school entertainer.
And we danced our nights away.
Like to be a showman.
Now my love, you change.
Like to go out there and sell a song and sell it to people.
Good memories.
is gone and life moves on. Working with Jules on the orchestra, it gives me that power behind me to be able to do that.
If you dress, hey, put that red dress on. If you dress just like you did before, and I'll love you again. If you dress just like you did before. London.
I mean, I'm very lucky to be alive in a lot of ways, because I'm sure I've OD'd a few times. Then you end up in rehab, which both of us did at various times, and, you know, you end up having to try and get off these things. We'd stopped doing Soft Cell, and then I didn't hear Mark for a while. Then we did some Soft Cell reworks, I think. So this door that seemed to have been firmly shut, was suddenly there was a crack of light coming through this door. And then a bit later, you sort of phoned me up and said, do you fancy just writing some songs? Written about four or five songs, and Mark had done the vocal, and we looked at each other and was like, it's Soft Cell, isn't it? It was obvious.
Well, it has to be, really.
It was obviously Soft Cell, so that's kind of how that came about. And so that album, you know, materialised, and it was... It wasn't really planned as a reunion in Soft Cell, was it?
No, I think when you resurrect the name of a band, a brand name, say of a band, there's always, and you think, oh, am I resurrecting a monster?
Photo shoots, just like Mark lying on the carpet and me lying there with just these outstretched hands, and this person had put a light behind this leather sofa. The next thing, there's like smoke and flames coming out of it. And we had to evacuate the hotel.
A typical Soft Cell. And that's the way it started. Really. That's the kind of portent of... So you knew Soft Cell were back because something like that happened.
The hotel nearly burned down.
The hotel nearly burned down. Oh, God.
But the night begins to turn your head around. And you know you're gonna lose more.
Had an accident, a very bad motorbike crash as well, which affected me very, very badly with head trauma. And you kind of lose your senses and you lose your emotions and you get mixed up with the personality that you are. I had to go back to singing lessons to get my confidence back to sing. I just couldn't remember how to sing as me. I was still recovering from post-traumatic stress. And I met Dave and I just had this awful meeting with him in the street. Felt the whole... Cruelty Without Beauty thing didn't end well.
I never expected we'd be doing this, because 2 years ago, you know, we weren't... I don't think we'd spoken for about 15 years or something. Met up socially, had a chat, and everything was fine. It was all forgive and forget, you know. And then it was sort of gradually came, would you be up for doing something live? And it was like, well, OK. And I didn't think it was going to be something as big as the O2. I thought it was going to be maybe a night or two nights at Brixton Academy, but it turned out to be this huge thing.
It's a great way of tying that up, coming back to kind of build that bridge, to heal that thing, and also to give the fans something which they've been waiting for a long time.
There is one song that we all have to sing together. One last song. Let's sing it all together now. And it goes like this.
Standing at the door of the Pink Flamingo, crying in the rain.
We're not going to tour again, and this will be the last standalone show, but who knows, there may be the odd one-off appearance. We've been writing new stuff together. We leave it open-ended, really. You know, it's an ongoing saga.
Say hello, goodbye. Say hello.
I think this is a good way of kind of like ending with a bang, the whole live thing. And I think you couldn't get any better than this.
Thank you.
for supporting us. It's not been an easy ride, but there have been moments of magic. In other words, it's been a blast. Thank you.
Next on BBC4, brilliant gritty drama, In the Line of Duty.